oh, you get depressed and, you know, this kind of thing, and it's momentary. It usually hits at night, but...
Being There is a comedy almost without gags. How does it produce laughter? Well, it's very slow burn, depending on an undercurrent of irony, as the simple-minded Chance the Gardener is mistaken by all he meets for a shrewd political expert. In the run-up to the era of Reagan, the idea of a holy fool rising to the top position in the land had more than a toehold in reality. Of course, today, the film's worst-case scenario looks nostalgically benign.
I am a very serious gardener.
Oh, I'm sure you are, Mr. Gardener. I'm sure you are.
Mark well.
Gobbledygook.
Great.
All you gotta be is white in America to get whatever you want.
The closest thing to gag-based comedy appears early on, as Chance, who has lived his whole life in the grounds of one house, is cast out into the streets of Washington. Director Hal Ashby, a former editor, was always a master of combining music and image, and here he pays backhanded tribute to Kubrick with Diodato's funky version of Thus Spake Zarathustra, starting Chance's odyssey off in grand style. The audiovisual synchronization is staggering, and staggeringly prolonged. Unlikely juxtapositions are one of the foundations of comedy, but Ashby doesn't let his contrasts develop into full-on absurdity. As Chance enters his brave new world, we get one form of surreal gag, the comparison of unlike things, which come to seem oddly connected. So modern Washington starts to remind us of outer space, its triumphal domes echoing Kubrick's eclipsed planets. Peter Sellers keeps things minimalist.
Excuse me, I'm very hungry. Could you give me some lunch?
The character comedian who delighted in eccentricity also had a fascination with the ordinary, and he wanted to play Chance as simply as possible. No mugging, no shtick, no goon show catchphrases. He used to claim that he had no personality of his own, or that he once had one, but had it surgically removed. What intrigued him about Jerzy Kosinski's source novel was the protagonist's blankness. He is as featureless as a mirror, in which the other characters see what they want.
It's always somewhat surprising to find men like yourself working so intimately with the president, and yet somehow managing to remain relatively unknown.
Yes, it is surprising. Yes.
There's an air of Stan Laurel about Sellers' performance, but with the slapstick stripped away. Sellers, a fan, visited Laurel, but was disturbed to find that his idol was not rich. Being there was a chance to have Stan rise to wealth and power. Slapstick depends on props. Chaplin's cane, Stan and Ollie's frequently swapped hats, and Chance has a signature prop of his own. He's been raised by television, and so he's never without his remote control. It hasn't occurred to him that it won't be much use without a set. Chance uses his remote when faced with a situation that seems to belong on TV. It doesn't work, but it prefigures the way the world is going to start falling into place around Chance. And again, it plays with the idea of odd collisions, the unreal and the real getting confused, objects forgetting their purpose and place, all of which is the stuff of gags. The film just doesn't allow the gags to actually happen. Sellers always said that Inspector Clouseau knew he was an idiot, which put him under a colossal strain because he mustn't let anyone else find out. But Laurel and Hardy were always blissfully unaware of their own mental shortcomings. Chance's wondrous placidity stems from his own unawareness. How sweet to be an idiot. And finally, at the end of his musical interlude, Chance finds a use for his remote control, and this brings him into accidental contact with another world, where he will magically acquire the power to change things just by pressing a button, just by speaking or smiling.
I understand.
Just by being there.